talk a little bit about that performance that you just saw, and then we're going to see it again. That was the winning, the championship performance of Love Me and the World Is Mine that Remasters did last year when they won the gold. And there are several things that we're going to look for in that particular song. I got the opportunity to work with them before that contest, so it was that, and of course they stay with us every time they come. When they come over to the States, they stay with David and me at the house, and so we got to know them as people as well as performers, and they do a lot of David's arrangements, so we got an opportunity to work with them. And what I want you to notice about it when you look at it again is that they've attached their lyric, their phrase plan to the lyrics, and that was very purposefully done. Barbershoppers have a tendency to keep us in the phrase plan, and they do that by directing themselves on stage, especially quartets. At the end of a long phrase, we see this, when actually the lyric may not say this. The lyric may talk about heart or talk about something ethereal. And so their phrase plan, their gesture plan, is attached to the lyric. Also, their face, we talked a lot about the mood of the music that they were singing and what the story was all about. We did some subtexting. That was really getting into, this was a difficult lyric because it's so flowery. A song that's written in the 1800s, isn't, we don't say oft would be and flowery words like that in some of our in general conversations. So we had to really break it down into a core essence and what the song was really about. And they actually had pictured their girls that they were singing this to, and so they did a lot of what's called fourth wall work, and that they were pulling the fourth wall very close in. So we'll see it again. I'm just going to see it one more time. And I'm going to talk over it. Come on, you guys, we haven't really started. This is the pre-class before the class. And then we're going to talk about why we do these things. So they walk on stage. They took their pitch, they faced the audience, they didn't turn in. They didn't want to break any barriers between the audience.
I wander on as in a dream, a dream of paradise.
So they're singing, and the whole essence, the core essence of the song was love. And how you're expressing love to your, in their case, their girlfriend. Or their wife, they're none of them are married, so they're girlfriends, or a girl. Many of them aren't attached, they just have lots of girls. So we talked about that and how you would lean into this girl and have an intimate conversation with them. So they're not singing to the back wall, they're singing to the judges or closer. And so there isn't going to be a whole lot of focused eye to the middle of the house. It's going to be brought back in very close. The lead is the one that you're watching, Rasmus. His hands are highest. We always look at the one whose hands are highest. And so the rule was, if Rasmus has his hands down, put your hands down. If Rasmus puts his hands up, then it's okay to accentuate, as long as your hands aren't higher than Rasmus's hands. So you'll see that, and you'll see that they follow that very well, so that your focus as an audience is on the one whose hands are highest, which is Rasmus the lead. Come on in, it's okay, we haven't really started. This is just a precursor. It's a long class, I'm trying to get the lot in. Ethereal and almost into their head. eyes may close, they may get a little bit dreamier looking, but that was all part of their illusionary plan.
Dare I hope to
moving more towards is a cappella musical theater. And And we're seeing a lot of it already on stage. I mean, those of you who watched the webcast or who were in Toronto saw some pretty phenomenal, especially from the choruses, but not just choruses, but quartets also, giving us some a cappella musical theater. I mean, it's beyond choreography now, and now we're into staging and actually living the drama and getting more and more involved in the theater and of barbershop and of presenting a piece of music into a performance. So, well, let's look at what presentation did. In presentation category, we were listening also, and what that did, not that we're not going to listen, we are going to listen, but because we are part of the audience, it's going to be, we're going to be more focused on how the audience is reacting to the things that are happening on stage and how does it viscerally connect with us as judges. So we were looking at how it sounded, and if it sounded good, that there was a score for that, but we have a singing category that takes care of that. And so I think that a lot of undue attention was being made on the singing part of it, and so we were finding that some groups were winning in presentation, and that our scores were inflated. That if a comedy group had a big finish and got a standing ovation, they got a big score, not really taking into consideration that there might have been only one or two good jokes in there and the rest of it was pretty, you know, okay. And so we're going to be a little smarter at the way we look at an overall performance and not just a big finish. Did the audience like it? That's going to be a big, that was always a big part of it. We would listen, we would watch, we would listen for the joke, for the laughter and the applause and the participation. And presentation category reward of that. We talked about theme. We talked about theme a lot. Wow, that's moving. The moving part can't lean up against the moving part. We talked about theme, lyrical theme, rhythmic theme, harmonic, comedic. We talked a lot about theme, and it was part of the presentation category. We are taking that completely out now because so many of what things that we did had a lyric theme, but was a rhythm song, or had a rhythmic theme, but also had a story. And so what we're doing is just bring it on, let's see what it looks like, let's see how it's presented and how it makes us feel inside. And so that, we were theme driven. If it was comedy, was it funny? Did it have certain criteria like focal points? We had focal points in there, we looked and we watched and they looked in a certain place, so we'll write that down, notate, you know, that we saw that focal point, and did we, and the interaction, and the vocal color, and all that. But what was happening is, we were becoming like the old arrangement category, where we were giving plus points for the focal point, plus points for the interaction, and oh yeah, they had a dynamic contrast in there, so we'll give them a couple of extra points for that. And it was keeping us in the technique of it, and we weren't really judging the overall performance of it. We were just judging the components of it. And so even though there will be components to performance, it won't be keeping us in the technique quite so much. And the high energy choreography, people were winning because they had lots of high energy choreography, but did it really go with the lyric? Did it really have anything at all to do with anything in the song? And are we getting too gymnastic out there? Do we need to pull it in just a little bit and not, because there are lots of choruses that don't have people who can do backflips. And maybe that isn't really all that important in a song about Dixie, you know? So we started talking as the category went into sessions this year in July and realized that maybe we're judging this the wrong way. Maybe we need to really take a look at the category as a whole and put in some different components so that, and the performance will do whatever we say we're gonna look at. Isn't that true? I mean, if you know the rules, you're gonna play the game. So let's take a look at what the problem was. Quartets and choruses were manufacturing a performance and getting credit for it. Comedy was based on a couple of good laughs mixed in with a bunch of lame jokes. And And as you know, by the monk set and the year before, the caveman set, the monk set should never have been in the top 10. It was awful. It was clever at the beginning when they first started walking out, and then it was like, really? So we looked at that this year in the category school and started going, you know, it's not really that funny. Why did it make the top 10 when there were groups that sang and looked well and really had emotion-driven songs? Were we sending the wrong message to our contestants that, okay, if you do something stupid, it's going to show up in a high score? And so we started to look at that. Groups were being overscored for devices rather than creating a musical, visceral experience. And so we talked about it. And it was really led by Dave McKechern from Toronto, Northern Lights. He's a theater guy. He was talking about theater and what they look for in that theater, and it all started to make a lot of sense, and we got so excited about it. So, we're talking about scoring the performance. During a performance, the audience and the performance judge interpret the presentation through their eyes and ears simultaneously. That is going to be how we're really going to look at it. Now, I'm going to show you some video here and there. This is an old, really old, like from the 80s. by the hairstyles and everything. This is Mandy Patinkin, and he just picks up a microphone and starts singing to a piano, with a piano in the background. And it hits you on a visceral level. Led us into that story in a very quick way. We were drawn in and we stayed there. And that's performance. That's the essence and the core of what you're going to be watching and listening for, is to get into the emotion of it right away, to make it real and believable. And the only way that it can truly be real is if it really is real. You can create an illusion to a point, but at some point, that illusion becomes your real feeling. And so that was pretty amazing. And so what we're going to look at to what constitutes a performance, if we just look at the word perform, the per means thoroughly, fournier is a French word meaning to complete. So what happens during a performance is that the performer gives to the audience, and then the audience gives it back in energy and in emotion, and that circle completes, so that there's a give and take, so that as the performer gives it up for the audience will give it up for the performer. And that that circle happens. The art of performance, and this is right out of what we discussed at the at Barbershop Harmony Society, the willingness and the ability to artistically convey stage-worthy things in a fashion that highly entertains. And then what we did was we broke each of those four elements down to willingness. Great performing requires courage and willingness to offer a transparent and generous gift to the audience. It's not easy to make yourself vulnerable and to have the audience see what is a true inner feeling. There it is at the bottom. And then ability, the skill in vocal production, music and communication. We have to have the skills. We have to have the ability to do it, and that's where the ongoing work happens. We continue to work for the best in vocal production and the best skill level that we can bring to our musical product. But then, after the ability and the willingness to do it, it becomes stage worthy. If it is to be on stage, it should be worthy, larger than life, significant and relatable. And we started looking at music selection even. And when you select your music, select something that is worth putting that kind of emotion into. There are some songs that we sing that just don't go anywhere. And there's gonna be a score for that. It's beyond the vocal, the arrangement itself, the form and all that. If it can't be played dramatically, then, you know, maybe it's just a fluff piece and it won't carry a very high score. So the higher scoring songs are going to be the deeper songs, the songs that have more into them. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. And then the things, the stories, the lessons, the jokes, the bits, the shticks, experiences, beliefs, ideas, thoughts, expressions, hopes, and dreams. Those are the kinds of meaty pieces that we're going to be wanting to see. Now that opens up a lot of doors. I mean, obviously most of the pieces that we do, because they were written in a time when you expressed love and devotion or hurt and angst, that you'll be able to throw that passion behind the music and actually be able to express it. So the willingness and ability to artistically convey stage-worthy things in a fashion that highly entertains is going to be the key to getting the high score in the performance category. So what is entertaining? The conveyance is the what. That's you're going to have to tell a story so that it is either through your vocal skills, the dynamic contrast, the air that you put around your sound, the different vocal colors that you use. That's going to be the what. The tools, how you do it, is going to be like your sets and your props and things like that that you're going to be go into this even in greater depth later in this class. And that's going to be the outcome. So the what and the how is going to equal what comes out. Have you seen this one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This is very powerful. Now, is she a good singer? She can't sing at all. I mean, really, if I were a singing judge, she would not get a very high score. But since I'm now judging the performance of this in this category, in the performance category, is going to get a very high score because she's truly believable. So let's watch her here.
Are we a pair? Me here at last on the run. You here in the air. Send in the clouds. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps telling Don't you love fuss? My fault, I hear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry, my dear. But where are the clowns? Quick, send in the clowns. Don't bother. They're here.
Desiree, I'm sorry. I should never have come. To flirt with rescue when one has no intention of being saved. Do try to forgive me.
The lesson, that if there's a lesson in the story, if there's a joke, we're going to, that's going to be a bit. Fred was famous for bits. You know, they were funny, but they had this overall bit thing going, yeah. And the shtick, if it's a pratfaller or whatever they're doing throughout the group. And it could be an experience, a belief, idea, thought, expression, hope, and these are all the what's. Those are, and most songs that we sing have at least one of those what's in there. And so we're going to be capturing, and in most cases, what we do is a story. That's why it's number one. You know, we tell a story. But the story may be based on a belief or a dream or an experience. So that could be, it could be more than one what. The tools, the how we do it, is sometimes it's tempo driven, sometimes it's rhythm driven. And not to confuse the two, one is the speed, the tempo is the speed, but the rhythm could be, is it 2-4 backbeat, is it 1-3 march time, is it an accent of 3 jazz march, you know, there's different ways that you can bring that story to life in a performance. Is intonation, tuning is still going to be an issue. We never want to let go of tuning. Because that throws the audience into a different place. If it's in tune, we stay with the story. If it's out of tune, we become aware of it as an audience, because we're pretty smart. Our audiences are getting more and more sophisticated the more we know. And you know that from just coming to these schools and learning, and then you go out in the real world and you hear performers perform, and you're really drawn into that out of tuneness, or the vowels that don't match and things like that. That we become educated to the point where we can't really enjoy things anymore. The melody line is a how. The harmonies that we use, the lyrics, staging, choreography, props, sets, lighting, costumes, character development, and timing, and the approach. Any fourth wall, direct contact, comedy shop, etc. So that's all going to be part of the tools that we bring that what to life. So we have a good story and it's got a good emotional hook. We're going to use maybe our good singing style and maybe our costume to set a character, and we're going to put all those elements together in our toolbox to present it to an audience. Fourth wall. Okay, let me go back to that. Fourth wall is a theater technique. In a theater, you have four walls to your theater. You have the back wall is number one, stage right is number two, stage left is number three, and then number four, the fourth wall, is wherever the performer chooses to put it. And Uta Hagen was a famous stage actress from Sweden. She's done a lot of, now she's teaching. In fact, she might have died, I don't even know. It's a long time ago. But Uta Hagen developed the fourth wall technique when she had to go up to a dressing table that had a mirror that was cut out on stage. And she went up to the mirror and she defocused on the audience, focused on the mirror. And she, like she was fixing her hair. And then she stepped aside and began to address the audience. And what she talked about was bringing it in very intimately. And when performers close their eyes, they shut out the audience completely. They're totally in their head, or they maybe are just like they're looking to one person, or maybe they're going to look at the first row of the house. But then they might widen their gaze and look out into the other. We've now pushed the fourth wall back into the audience. We can push the fourth wall to the back wall, and we can push it beyond the back wall. But that's fourth wall technique. And a lot of performers in barbershop use fourth wall technique. It's something that we've talked about for a few years, even in the old presentation category, and I think in stage presence before that, where we actually brought in, and we would talk about bringing in the fourth wall to make it more intimate between the performer and the subject of the song. And we saw a little bit of fourth wall technique in the ringmasters. Yeah. Where they really brought that into an intimate place, where they were just talking one-on-one, and the audience was just watching that whole scenario. Sometimes the audience is included and sometimes they're not. Outcome would be the expression and emotion, the understanding of the material that you're seeing, the approach to how you do it, whether it's comedic or whether it's dramatic or whether it's rhythmic. That's the old theme part right there in the approach that you take. And it, is the technique absorbed so that it's just, you just know it? And is the performance absorbed so that you just do it? So it's knowing and doing and having that have impact on the audience. The rapport that is created, the engagement between performer and the audience, the believability, if it feels real to the audience, the perceived believability, and the entertainment value of it, the mood that's created, the suitability to the performer. And suitability to the performer, we talked about that a lot. And as we invite younger guys into our organization, it's going to be obvious that some guys, young, shouldn't sing songs about like when we used to be on stage and how my voice isn't the way it used to be and I'm an old guy now. You know, there are some things that are beyond a performer's capability. The song that the chorus is singing about the silver hair and the when your gold hair is now silver, that's an old guy's song. And it won't be believable to the audience unless they're talking about their mom. I mean, it just isn't gonna happen. And conversely, a bunch of old guys can get up there and say, "Ma, he's making eyes at me," and really have it be believable. So there's certain roles that you need to take on that are going to be believable to the audience. And so selecting music that fits your group is going to kind of have an important impact. Is it suitable to the performer? Also, is it suitable in range and, you know, that kind of stuff too? And just, can the performer, is it too deep of a song? Sometimes we choose music that has such a dramatic hook that it's beyond the capability of the performer to be able to really get that across in a meaningful way. So, you know, there's going to be a trade-off, and we are going to be talking about suitability to the performer as we get more and more involved in this new system. So, I want you to see what freedom looks like. I love Freddie Mercury. You know, I just have always been a Queen fan. And this is just one of his improvisations. Now, he used to improvise a lot there's lots of YouTube videos of him improvising with his audience. This is just one of them. It's a short clip. But he had such a marvelous way of connecting with his audience. So,
you know,
Looking exit sign. Yeah, I put that. That goes back to that old focal point thing. Remember? Oh yeah, right here at this part. Let's look up at the exit sign. So we're all looking at the same place. Well, you know, if you walk by somebody and they're looking up, don't you look up there to see what they're looking at? You know, it's like you want to turn around and go, what's back there? What are they all looking at? It needs to have meaning. Everything that we do on stage has to have meaning. And if it doesn't, then it probably isn't stage worthy. Remember, we want stage worthy things. Mechanical moves, moves that have no real meaning. Jumping around on stage, doing cartwheels and flips, if it's not some song that determines that. Now, it could be a joyful song, and that might be it, but you see some performances that are getting so gymnastic now that that's really the thing, and really what we're doing is kind of accompanying some dance. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. We're singers first, and the choreography comes late. That's the frame for the picture. And so the staging and choreography should be a tool to convey it to the audience with the message of the song. So, okay, so making it real. If you're not emotionally pregnant when you start the song, you're not going to give birth to the dust. I thought that was so poignant. I wrote that one down. Dave McEachern is an actor, and he's the guy I was talking to you about at Toronto. He's the one that comes up with, he's the genius behind the vegetables and behind the Buddy, Can You Spare a Dime set and all that, if some of you guys remember that. He's just a genius when it comes to staging. And those were his words, and I just thought that was so true. If you aren't emotionally connected to the song that you're singing, then there's hardly any way that you can deliver a real message to the audience. And he talked to us a lot about real. And that really, if you know the technique of it, if you know what joy looks like, you can create a pretty decent illusion of joy. And oh, by the way, you'll probably feel joy at some point during the song because your body language is saying what it is. Or love, or angst, or anger, or whatever the message of the song is. If you don't feel it, why should your audience care? And that was one of the things that he talked to all of us about, is when you're sitting in an audience and you just don't care, then that's probably not a very good performance. But if you're invested in it emotionally, then that performer's doing something really right, and that deserves a comment and a reward. Is it believable? Is it funny? Is it expressive? Is it entertaining? Is it stage-worthy? Is it transparent? Is it generous? Absorbed? Well, I'm gonna show another one. I'm gonna go back to that first before we. Any questions about any of this stuff?
Can you explain transparency?
Yes, I sure can. We talked a lot about transparency. Looking inside the performer. When we saw Judi Dench, we saw her soul. We felt her pain. And that is transparency. That's when you can actually get inside the person and that they're showing us true emotion, raw emotion, and or joy. A song doesn't have to be hurt and grief and agony, and you know, it can be joy and fun and or funny or love or whatever other emotion it is, but it has to be clear that if you're singing a song about joy, about, you know, when the Red Red Robin goes ba 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 along, and that's a joyful song, you're just skipping, wake up you sleepyhead, you know, the world is right and it's morning and I love it, you know, that's, but it has to feel transparent to the audience. You have to believe that's really what this performer is feeling at the time. So that's transparency. Generous, we talked about generosity too, the freedom to actually show it and give it. And it takes courage. It takes a great deal of courage to get on stage and be vulnerable and transparent like that. You know, you're taking the risk that someone won't believe you or that they will laugh. But that vulnerability has to be there. That transparency and generosity has to be there. Okay? All right, let's watch Usher. I like Usher. I like a lot of British performers, actually. This is There Goes My Baby. And I want you to see his love.
Yeah, man.
Life experience has a lot to do with this song. The judgments that Jesus are real, raw judgments. Getting some help for these choruses and quartets that are scoring that low, so that maybe they, before they go back out in public and represent you and me, that maybe they should be a little bit higher in their scores. So the art of performance, the willingness and ability to artistically convey stage-worthy things in a fashion that highly entertains. That was our mission. That was our mission statement that we came up with. And I'm going to show you the vegetable set, not the whole set, just the one song, just the first song, because it has all of those elements of believability. Everything that's in there was done for a purpose. The audience leading, you know, when the cabbages were performing, we looked at the cabbages because the stage performers turned towards the cabbages and the whole audience looked at them. And to the flowers, when they go like this in the background, they all move together. So it was just
to cry.